Take a look at this. And this. And even this. These are scenes from the cutting edge of robotics. For years, we have seen these incredible videos surface online. But then, this is the world most of us actually live in. A reality defined by a collection of stubbornly analog tools. It raises a pretty obvious question. Why is there such a huge gap between the robots on screen and the world we are still stuck in? To understand this gap, it helps to look at who builds these machines. For decades, advanced robotics has been the exclusive domain of massive tech corporations and well-funded research labs. These are billion-dollar projects built behind closed doors. Their technology is locked away, a closely guarded secret. So that leads to the real question that started me on this journey. Is it actually possible for one person with no access to these secrets to bridge that gap? Could someone in their own home build a sophisticated biped robot today? Building a robot like this is like creating a living being from scratch. First, you need a skeleton, a lightweight, strong frame. Next, its organs and nervous system, the electronics, the motors and sensors. And finally, everybody needs a mind, the computer and the AI code that you have to teach from nothing. So my first step wasn't to invent something from scratch, but to find a proven blueprint. My research led me to MIT and their fantastic open source mini JTA project. So I took the core concept and started designing my first prototype, the Wiredgeist Mk1. The goal was to adapt the JTA's quadruped principles into a bipedal form. The most important rule was keeping those actuators, the muscles, clustered around the hip to minimize the inertia of the leg. The workflow starts at the most fundamental point, a blank 2D sketch in the CAD software. First, I had to design every single component individually, then bring them all into a digital assembly, fitting them all together perfectly. Next came a crucial step. I needed to simplify the parts. All the extra details were computationally expensive, so I stripped the model down to its essential geometry. And finally, preparing the URDF export itself. This meant building the robot's kinematic tree, defining how each part connects from the torso all the way down to the feet. With those final steps, the body was forged. I exported the file and the digital twin was finally ready for its mind. So I had the body, but how do you actually train the brain? How do you go from a lifeless digital model to something that can think for itself? The answer lies in creating a digital world for it to live and learn in. A place with gravity, friction and consequences. For this project, that world is called NVIDIA Isaac Sim. But the playground needs rules. The training itself is based on a simple idea, reinforcement learning. It's like teaching a puppy. Every fraction of a second, the AI gets a report card with points for good behavior and penalties for bad behavior. I had to write the rules myself. Is your torso upright? Good, here's a point. Are your feet flat on the ground? Excellent, have another point. Did your knee just hit the floor? Bad, minus 10 points. And the biggest penalty for all was reserved for falling over completely. The AI's only goal is to get the highest score possible. But here's where it gets truly powerful. We don't have to teach one robot at a time. Isaac Sim lets us use what I call the shadow clone technique, creating thousands of copies of the robot that can all learn simultaneously. Each copy experiences something slightly different. Every lesson from every single clone, both the success and the failures, is pulled together. This massively parallel approach dramatically accelerates the learning process. But all of this is running on this. A mid-range gaming computer, built for under 2000 euros. The key is an NVIDIA RTX 4070 Ti with 12GB of VRAM. And remember that crucial step earlier when I simplified the polygons of my model to reduce the computational load? This is where that preparation pays off. By being efficient in the design phase, I can now push my computer to its absolute limit. And with this hardware, I'm able to train 16,384 copies of my robot, all at the same time. This is nuts. The process was a grind, millions of failures and hours of tweaking those reward and punishment values. And then after days of training, finally, success. Perfect balance. For a moment, it felt like I had cracked the code. Well, the Mk1 was never meant to be the final product. It was more like a proof of concept. It proved the whole workflow from a 3D model to a URDF file and then to a fully trained AI model was possible for one person to achieve on his mid-range gaming computer. That success with the Mk1 just flipped the switch in my head. With the basic concept proven, I felt the freedom to get truly obsessive with the details for Mk2. The new mantra became, do it right or don't do it at all. So I went back to the drawing board. This wasn't just a redesign, it was a complete reimagining. The goal was to design a robot approximately 1 meter tall with a frame made almost entirely from 66-1 aluminium. At this time, I started using advanced techniques like topology optimization to create parts that have the maximum strength for the minimum weight. This also opens the door to using lattice infills, which is perfect because I wasn't planning for traditional CNC milling but for advanced manufacturing like metal 3D printing. The entire mechanical design philosophy changed. For the hip, the actuators are now slightly angled, provide a more natural range of motion. Unlike the Mk1, which tried to centralize the motors, the Mk2 places most of actuators directly at their joints. This is only possible because the new actuators I selected are powerful enough to handle the weight directly, which simplifies the design immensely. The one exception is the knee. To get the immense power needed for pushing off the ground, I designed a special transmission system here. It's a 4-bar linkage, a type of crank rocker mechanism. And this leads to the core actuator strategy. You can't just use the same motors everywhere. It's about using the right tool for the right job. For the core foundation, the hips, knees and waist, I chose the most powerful actuators. This is where you can't compromise. You need the maximum power for stability. For the shoulders and the critical ankle pitch, a slightly lighter but still very powerful workhorse actuator providing strong dynamic movement. And finally, for joints like the elbows and ankle roll, where minimizing weight is key, I used the lightest motors possible. This reduces inertia, making the limbs faster and more agile. With the strategy set, I could plan out the entire bill of materials, every single component needed to bring this machine to life. First the brain, a powerful embedded AI computer to run the control software, also the weights later on, connected to the muscles via a network of communication adapters, using the well-known control area network protocol, shortly for CAN bus. Next the heart, a high discharge LiPo battery feeding power through distribution hubs. And finally the senses, starting with a simple IMU to feel acceleration and orientation, with a clear path to add LiDAR or cameras for vision later on. And after countless iterations, tweaking values by tiny fractions, I finally found a reward system that worked. And as you can see, I managed to make it walk. But the beautiful thing is, this isn't the end, this is the foundation. From here I can improve and adjusting the code, and the bot will keep walking better and better. I can train it to be more stable or faster. I can even start training entirely new movements, like crouching or turning in place. The digital twin is done. It's a validated working design and it's ready to be built in the real world. So after all this investigation, we come back to the original question. Is it possible for one person to build a sophisticated bipedal robot? Yes, absolutely. What you have just seen is a complete digital blueprint, a validated design that is ready to be built. But to call this a true success, a robot needs to leave the digital world and takes its first steps in reality. And that's where we hit the final and biggest hurdle, the paywall. A rough estimation to build the Mk2 with a full aluminium frame is somewhere in the range of 10 to 20,000 euros. It's a lot, but for what this machine is, it's incredibly cheap. And with the right community and clever sourcing, I believe that number could even go down. Actually, my dream is to make this entire process accessible to everyone. So to help you get started on your own journey, I'm making all the files for the Mk1 prototype, the CAD files, the URDF, everything you need to play around with in the simulator, completely free and open source on my GitHub. For those who want to go deeper and directly support this project's future, Patreon is where you can get the complete blueprint for the wired Geist Mk2. This includes everything from project files and tutorial. And honestly, I don't know exactly where this journey is heading, but I'm driven by the idea of a future where building our own robots is an open source reality. And that possibility is incredibly exciting. This project is my contribution, basically. A first step that I hope we can all build upon together. So thanks for following this digital journey. If this project comes to life, there will be a part 2, of course. Let me know in the comments what you want to see next. And if you want to be part of building that future, subscribe and hit that bell. We are just getting started, actually.